is that, what is the result of that? That no more individual complaints to the Human Rights Committee can be made, but the decision continues to draw criticism both here and abroad even today. The simple thing was that we could no longer go to the Human Rights Committee or whatever the committees were, whether it's CEDAW or CAT or Rights of the Child or whatever it was, but there was no question of going there, you know, sort of, and getting directions as to what we should do, and therefore that whole exercise became a nullity. Now, at every treaty, ladies and gentlemen, I can tell you that at every treaty body hearing, this judgment is held out as one of the retrograde steps that have been taken by ourselves to sound the death knell of international obligations that Sri Lanka undertook. Now, that's a criticism. I don't agree with that. I don't agree with that with all respect. But they continue to bombard us with that position that we have, do not live up to our international obligations in treaty, in terms of our treaty obligations. I ask you to pose the question, was it sovereignty that the court was thinking of when the court did this? When you read between the lines, the court, without saying we are going to take protection under sovereignty, said all kinds of other things. We said we are a dualist jurisdiction, a dualist country, and therefore we have our local laws. We got around it by perhaps using juristic mechanisms, quite cleverly and quite rightly perhaps. But was it the compromising of sovereignty that the court was really concerned about? That is my question. Was it the compromise of sovereignty that the court was really concerned about? Now, there are arguments for and against it. I'm sure the jurists will perhaps write volumes, and the media probably will write volumes on it as time goes on as to what the real reason was. Now, let me quote you another little question. When GSP Plus was being contested in Europe, in Brussels. Now, I would now cross over to Brussels, therefore, where an inquisition of sorts took place in order to see whether GSP Plus should be granted or not. Now, in an 8-hour session with the EU, Sri Lanka had to answer perhaps a marathon of an avalanche of questions, I would say, some of which turned into Sri Lanka's legal system, its laws and international obligations. And finally, the criticism was that we actually did not live up to our treaty obligations, and that was one of the issues that were taken up at the GSP. Now, there again, we put forward the question of sovereignty. So you see what sovereignty actually does to us. Now, Sri Lanka charged that we have been dictated. Now, our position was that we can't be dictated to by external forces, external countries. Now, I preface this presentation, ladies and gentlemen, by telling you that joining international organizations, although most laudable, for laudable reasons, can spell intrusions on our sovereignty. Now, our experience with GSP Plus is a classic example, as I said. Our experience with Sinarasa, another experience. Now, for example, by joining the WTO, the World Trade Organization, we become beneficiaries of GSP Plus. Imagine the conditionalities that comes with some of it, which are virtual intrusions of legislative power by joining the WTO. We are told to do this or you do not. Simply, we are told you do this or you do not get it. You do this or you will get it. That's what it is, what happens to our sovereignty. So I can go on, and let me conclude with examples of recent memory. I do not have to dwell upon once again the politicized nature of international obligations. Take our experience in the Human Rights Council last March, for example. No doubt, by virtue of being a United Nations member, obligations are assumed by us. But it does not mean long before the LLRC there had concluded its observations, its deliberations, we had to be threatened with a resolution. So much for our sovereignty. Now, in November of this year, Sri Lanka goes before the United Nations Human Rights Council once again for its Universal Periodic Review, which is a novel feature of the Human Rights Council. It is a peer review for which we are ready with milestones and with great achievements. Now, we undertook to put in place a national action plan to promote and protect human rights, which you probably know is the official document today. We are almost ready to showcase all our achievements, inclusive the recommendations of the LLRC and the steps taken to its implementation, and we are just about to launch very shortly. Now, What happens at the universal periodic review? We are completely open to be reviewed in every department of governance, whether it be the legislature, whether it be the judiciary, whether it be the executive. They can review any matter pertaining to the ICCPR, pertaining to the Convention on Torture, pertaining to CEDAW, pertaining to the rights of the child, on any one of those matters. So you see, what then happens to this great position, or this great kind of thing we enjoy as sovereignty? What happens to our sovereignty? So all this tells you only one thing, and that is that internal sovereignty therefore has eroded while the powers of international organizations have expanded. As long as they get diluted with politics and bias, I do not think we as a developing nation are ready to accept this expanding canvas. I think that's where we are. Now, before I just wind off on this whole question of sovereignty, what I'm simply, if I was to summarize it in say one or two sentences, what I'm simply saying is sovereignty on paper and sovereignty in real terms are perhaps two different things that we actually cannot reconcile. All this is perhaps good, nice little jurisprudential constitutional gymnastics that we can probably play. Is sovereignty then the plaything of a plaything for jurisprudential gymnastics, or do we really, really believe in real sovereignty? I'm not too sure whether one or the other is possible, but I'm fairly sure some medium, a combination of these two, perhaps diverse elements, is something that we probably can live with. Now, let me, before I finish, just tell you something about, I've been talking about domestic sovereignty, the sovereignty on the domestic canvas. Let me say just a word about the global canvas of sovereignty. The global canvas of sovereignty, can I just take 5 minutes? The global concept of sovereignty actually began, which was it came from what was known as the Westphalian sovereignty. The concept of nation state sovereignty. Now, I simply ask the question, nation state sovereignty, just think about it. What is the nation state sovereignty? Perhaps I was looking at some of the military interventions perhaps we have seen in recent times. For example, in the 20th century, the nation state sovereignty has been brought into further question by a range of actual and proposed military intervention in the form of, for example, Yugoslavia, in Afghanistan, in Iraq, and perhaps the Sudan, amongst others. Look at the humanitarian interventions that we have seen globally. The partial list includes the convention. I was looking at the list of humanitarian interventions. Cambodia by Vietnam, Bangladesh then part of Pakistan, Kosovo by NATO, the bombing of Yugoslavia in 1999, Iraq by the United States, invasions of Iraq, Georgia by Russia, Libya by NATO. These interventions, I say, ladies and gentlemen, had a questionable or perhaps weak basis in international law, but were carried out on the premise that they were constituted humanitarian interventions aimed at preventing genocide, large-scale loss of life, ethnic cleansing, or the use of weapons of mass destruction. Neoconservatism, ladies and gentlemen, in particular, has developed this line of thinking further, asserting that a lack of democracy may foreshadow future humanitarian crises, or that democracy itself constitutes a human right. That was the basis on which that was legitimized. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'm just showing you that to show you that even state, even perhaps the Westphalian concepts of nation state sovereignty today is something that is surely but crumbling. But if I put it this way, surely but can crumble under international pressure. Did we ever think of a united Europe? No. But today, Europe is sans borders. Sovereignty is something you are talking of, euro currency, you're talking of a euro central bank, you're talking of a euro common visa, what not. Where then is sovereignty? Will those concepts flow into Asia? A question. Whether again we are probably we might end up with an Asian common market. We might have with our Asian friends around here, we might be able to walk in and walk out of our countries. And that might be a good thing. And very interestingly, this is what nation state sovereignty, this is what perhaps Secretary General of NATO, Javier Solana, had to say with regard to nation state sovereignty. He said, nation state sovereignty, I'll read it for one, the principle of nation state sovereignty, it relied also on it produced rivalry and not community of states. Rivalry and not community of states. And it says it's produced exclusion and not integration. So then, can we really hold on to this so-called precious sovereignty that we are so jealously guarding in our constitutional documents in the new world order that we will see in the times ahead? Ladies and gentlemen, I think I've left you with enough thought to think about sovereignty. I'm sure there are better things to think about than sovereignty. But these are matters, I hope I was able to sensitize you to the need to perhaps think of these things and not get too sensitive and emotional when people talk of our sovereignty. Think about it. However sovereign we are, when we are in another land, we are willing to give up all the sovereignty and fall in line with some other sovereign. So I leave you with the thought, how sovereign is sovereignty? Thank you.